OK, good afternoon. So this is our first speaker in this afternoon. Syed Hamid Hassan Sadeh is going to talk about the most complete intersections with small multiplicities.
OK, thank you, Aaron. First, let me thank the organizers for the invitation. And actually, it's always a good opportunity for me to talk in ALGA. And ALGA is my favorite seminar, which a regular seminar here in Brazil. And it is especially because it has the word commutative algebra, which is my favorite field of study and research, of course. But anytime in ALGA, I try to find a more geometric topic because I knew that people here like geometry more. And but this time I actually decided to choose a very algebraic one. And the reason for that was that the work that I was working on was related to two important conjectures where both were solved just a couple months ago. So I'm so excited, you know, 2016 was very successful year for commutative algebra. So I decided, so maybe I take the advantage to talk here about those big conjectures and also my work, which is related to those conjectures. So the conjecture, so I will talk about conjectures. And so my results, actually our results. So this is a joint work with Ehsan Tavanfar. And third part of my talk will be about the applications in the theory of residual intersection. OK. So the conjecture that I would like to talk about are two conjectures. One is due to Melvin Hochster, and the other is the Estillman conjecture. So the Melvin Hochster conjecture is the direct summand conjecture. So the direct summand conjecture is very simple to state. So it says that when you are a regular local ring, and then you have a module finite extension, then this map splits. Simple like this. So S is R plus T. And you can imagine how many applications this kind of statement may have. And what Hochster made this conjecture in the 70s, and he proved that for ring which contains a field. OK, this is too much. Yes. S plus as R module. Yeah. OK, so he did it for any ring that contains a field. So it is too much, no? For almost everything in algebraic geometry or commutative algebra, a good example, has a field, contains a field. But the question was that he expected a result that works for any ring. So let me give a simple example here. So let's assume your local ring is just qxy localized in the maximal ideal qy, or your local ring be zx localized at prime number p and variable x. So these are two local rings of dimension 2, and both has characteristic 0. But there is a big difference here. If you go to the quotient field here, this is q. But if you go to the quotient field here, you find zp. And this is a field of characteristic p. This is a field of characteristic 0. And so this is a big difference between these. This case is called equicharacteristic. And this is mixed characteristic. And the point is that many good examples in number theory are mixed characteristic. And number theory is arithmetic. They are most interested in this type of rings. And this would be a theorem that will help them to apply in number theory. Okay, so the conjecture was open since 70s, and none of the method in commutative algebra or algebraic geometry were helpful to prove this conjecture. But finally, Peter Scholz appears, and he invented this characteristic P technique called perfectoid space. I think Schulze will be the next field medalist. And so then Yves André from Jussieu, so he applied the perfectoid space of Peter Schulze. So this technique only works in mixed characteristic and not in equicharacteristic. So he could finally settle the remaining piece of the direct summon conjecture and solve the conjecture in full generality. Okay. But the point is that during development to prove the direct summon conjecture, many other conjectures were made. And actually, there is a big tree of homological conjecture. So I would like to actually start to explain the tree because I want to talk about one of them at the top. Okay, so to talk about that, I need to introduce again and again the Cohen-Macaulay notation. Okay, so in commutative algebra, we abbreviate CM, and it is not complex multiplication. It is Cohen-Macaulay. Okay? Okay, so what is Cohen-Macaulay modulus? So let's assume you have a Noetherian ring. Let X be the spec of R. Let U be the open, you just take out the single point M. Let M be a finitely generated R module. Let if F be the sheafification of M, then the I-th local cohomology of M we denote by HIMM, and this is just the sheaf homology module of the open space, open subset U with sheaf F. This is for I bigger than 2. And for I 0 and 1, we have this restriction map. The kernel of this guy is H0. And co-kernel of this guy is H1. OK, so I have H0, H1. And then Grothendieck vanishing theorem says that HDMM is not 0 when D is dimension of M. And above this guy, everything is 0. So I have a finite number of homologies. For any module. And so the first non-zero index, so let's assume everybody is zero here, and this is the first non-zero one. So the first non-zero index is called depth of M. OK, so you have your range of 0 to the dimension of a module. And then the first non-zero index is called depth of M. So clearly, depth is less than dimension. OK, so a module, so a finitely generated R module is called maximal Cohen-Macaulay. If this tree inequality is exactly an equality. Actually, when these two happens, it is simply called Cohen-Macaulay. But if three happens, then it's called maximal Cohen-Macaulay. OK? this is for finitely generated module. And in general, if M is not assumed to be finitely generated, we say that maybe non-finitely generated R module. One can also use this definition, but if you want to be very careful. So a non-zero finitely generated is maximal Cohen-Macaulay if any system of parameters of R is a regular sequence. Or. But essentially the same definition. Anyway, so a module is Cohen-Macaulay if depth of the module is the same as dimension, if there is only one non-zero local cohomology module. And so the question is that, okay, so if the ring is Cohen-Macaulay, then I have a Cohen-Macaulay module, which is the ring itself. But if the ring is not Cohen-Macaulay, so a very simple question is that does maximal Cohen-Macaulay modules exist? So simple. So you are given a ring, and you are wondering if there exists at all a maximal Cohen-Macaulay module or not. Okay. So this is what is called the B Cohen-Macaulay conjecture. So the B Cohen-Macaulay conjecture asserts that yes, there exists. Always there is a module. Whatever your ring is, there is a Cohen-Macaulay module. Maybe not finitely generated, but there is a Cohen-Macaulay module over your ring. And Hackester again at the same year, so he proved B Cohen-Macaulay conjecture for rings that contains a field for equicharacteristic rings, but it remained open for mixed characteristic. So the trees that I wanted to talk is this one. So a small Cohen-Macaulay conjecture. This is the statement that asserts that always there is a finitely generated R module, which is Cohen-Macaulay. And big, so a small means finitely generated. And B Cohen-Macaulay is not necessarily finitely generated. And then appears the direct summon conjecture. And as I said, there is a tree here. So direct summon conjecture is imply monomial conjecture or the canonical element conjecture. And this, or any of them, actually, this is not a tree without loop. It has loop, but even, you know, very short loops. But anyway, so there is a new intersection conjecture, so many things here. Okay? And what actually Yves Andreff did, he first proved direct summon conjecture in mixed characteristic, and then he completed big Cohen-Macaulay conjecture in mixed characteristic. And so joined with the Hackester work, so now B Cohen-Macaulay conjecture is true, and so it implies everything here. So what we are doing, we are using this, and we attribute to prove some part of a small Cohen-Macaulay conjecture. So we prove a small Cohen-Macaulay conjecture for a special type of rings. Okay, so this was the first conjecture that I would like to talk. Any question? Okay, so the second conjecture is the Stillman's conjecture. Actually, this is a rather new conjecture. It is open since 2009, but it is a very bold conjecture. So it was very important too. That is a little bit historical, but the other is more, a brave conjecture. So Stillman is one of the developers of Macaulay 2 software. So he had, you know, lots of experimental in computation, looking at the resolution of an ideal and so on. So to explain Stillman conjecture, let me go back to the Hilbert CG theorem. So Hilbert CG theorem is a very important theorem in commutative algebra, and is asking to replace an object with nice object, and and to hide the complication of the structure of the ideal in the map while we are working with simple object, but where we may have different maps. For example, you have your ideal x square xy y square in the ring kxy. Okay, of course, this is not a free R module, but this has three generators, so you can send e1 to x square, e2 to xy, e3 to y square. But if you do this map, then this map may have some kernel, for example, y e1 minus x e2, this guy goes to 0, or y e2 minus x e3 also goes to 0, and any other relation between these generators are generated by these two. So the kernel of this map is generated by two generators, so you can find another map and you map to these generators and combine them to put them here. And if you repeat this, you will have free resolution for your object. And if you repeat this minimally, you will have a minimal free resolution for your object. And the length of minimal free resolution is called the projective dimension. It may be infinite, know that. But the Hilbert-Cz theorem asserts that. So Hilbert-Cz theorem and it is exactly what Hilbert proved. He proved that when you have a polynomial ring with n variables, okay, the projective resolution of any ideal stop before n step. Okay, so if you have two variables, first, at worst, second is enough to have your resolution exact. I mean, by exact, I mean finally, this map is injective. And so you don't need to go back and back again. Okay? So it is very important theorem in commutative algebra. We use almost every day. And so it gives an upper bound for the projective resolution of anything. And it is the Hilbert-Cz theorem. What a Stillman conjecture was that he said that given two integers, r and d, so there exists a function in terms of r and d such that any ideal with r equations of degree d has projective dimension at most f of rd. So this is very interesting. It says that, for example, if you have three quadrics, so for example, let's assume f3, 3, 2 is 4. So then the projective resolution of three quadrics is always 4. If you have 100 of variables or 1,000 of variables or millions of variables, it doesn't get to million. It only needs 4. So the length of the projective dimension depend on the structure of the ideal instead of the structure of the ambient. This is a very interesting thing.
This is in any polynomial ring over any field?
Oh, yes, sorry. So the main conjecture was about polynomial ring over a field, so K field. So the point here is that independent of n, actually, the first conjecture was that f can be a polynomial, but then counterexample shows that no, f is not a polynomial. So the conjecture remained that there is an independent function of n that bound the projective dimension. So this was, you know, very simple conjecture, but motivated many people since 2009 to solve this conjecture. And people, you know, tried many special cases like three quadrics, three cubic, four quadric, and so on, to see what is really happening and to find the true pattern to prove the Stillman conjecture. And so the nice thing is that in October, so Huckster and Ananian. So they could settle this conjecture in a very interesting way. So actually, they proved that always there is a function, for any R and D, there is a function FRD, such that you can embed your variety in a limited number, in a space of limited dimension, and the rest of the variables which are actually involved in the structure is just a flat extension of base field, of base ring. So for example, three quadrics can be embedded in a space, let us assume, with 100 variables, and if you have million of variables in the equation of this quadrics, this is just a flat extension of your space. So your variety, so the structure of the variety actually depends on the equation, not at the ambient that the variety is living in. This is what Ananian and Huckster prove. And so in particular, joining this with Hilbert's theorem will prove the Stillman conjecture. So and the rest is just nothing. The point is that the function that they have found is a horrible function. It's many, 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 many exponential, but doesn't have any n. It has only d. But anyway, so they could prove the Stillman conjecture. And our result will also solve, will give a nice upper bound for Stillman conjecture for three quadrics. OK? Good. I think I'm ready to go to the second part. There is, I don't know how many potential appear here, but it depends on R. It is a very many exponential number, but doesn't have any n. This is the point. It is a bad number. Even for very simple structure like three quadrics, the estimation is too high. But there is no n. And it means that, okay, your variety can be embedded in a smaller space, and the rest of variables is just a trivial flat extension.
So in practice you reach n, whatever n you want.
Okay, now the challenge now is, yes. The challenge toward the Stillman conjecture is what is the best FRD that you can bound the projective dimension. Yeah. But it is already a big achievement, I think.
Good question.
Let's see. Yeah, you know, okay, I see what you mean. Yeah, there is an expectation. For example, the projective dimension of R mod I is depths of R minus depths of R mod I by Oslander-Buxbaum formula. So I think, I don't know, maybe.
There is a lower bound. There are some examples that are very good. The problem is when every study class, and you have a bound, then you just take it. When you start another class, you take the highest of the two.
No, I think a good question is if we have kind of non-trivial, I mean, of course, if you have an ideal given by one, yeah, or everybody has the same, a common divisor, you know, Then this. So if we forget this kind of trivial thing, so is there any lower bound? I don't know. But finding upper bound is more interesting, I think. Okay, so we get to the result here. So I'm going to talk about almost complete intersections. So what is an almost complete intersection? I'm sure everybody here knows complete intersection, but so let R be the quotient of a regular ring by an ideal F1 FR. So we say that R is complete intersection if codimension of R is exactly number of equations here. So it is called almost complete intersection if codimension of R is exactly one less than number of required equation here. Okay, so very close, just one less step before complete intersection is called almost complete intersection, but the difference between these two classes is too much. For instance, for many years it was known that if one can prove Bicoy-Macaulay conjecture for almost complete intersection, then it is true for any ring. But nobody could prove this for almost complete intersection, for example. But so we start working on this question because we first observed that if a small Cohen-Macaulay conjecture holds for almost complete intersection, then it is true. So it seems that this almost complete intersection is the first non-trivial class of ideals. But actually, our motivation to work was not this observation. It was by studying a paper of Hunike, Monteiro, McGla, and Celestiano in 2015. So here in this paper, they studied the multiplicity of almost complete intersection. So let me recall the definition of multiplicity. So we know that when you are given a local ring, so the length function is eventually a polynomial ring. Okay. So D is dimension, here is D factorial, and the coefficient here is called the multiplicity of a ring. And this coincides with our naive interpretation of multiplicity if ring is Cohen-Macaulay. I don't want to talk about that. But anyway, so here, these guys try to prove the Stillman conjecture in some special cases. But they have found a very interesting inequality for multiplicity of complete intersection. So they prove that multiplicity of a complete intersection is at most, so let's assume you have R generators, and you assume you have a polynomial ring here. And you assume we have R generators, and this guy has degree D, 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 D. So they prove that the multiplicity is at most D to the R minus 1 minus R minus 2, D minus 1. So they found a uniform upper bound for the multiplicity of almost complete intersection. And they also proved that this equality happens if S mod I If this equality happens, then S mod I is Cohen-Macaulay. Okay, with equality if and only if S mod I is Cohen-Macaulay. But here at the same paper, they prove an old result of Pierre-Samuel, wherein Samuel proved that if S mod I is an almost complete intersection, so S is a polynomial ring over a field, if this guy is almost complete intersection and multiplicity of this guy is at most 1, then 1 is bigger than dimension of R minus depth of R. This is a very interesting result of Samuel. Very old result, but were forgotten for many years. But essentially, Samuel says that if an almost complete intersection has the smallest possible multiplicity, it is almost Cohen-Macaulay. It is very close to Cohen-Macaulay. Remember, I said it is Cohen-Macaulay when dime minus depth is 0. But here is at most 1. So we have 2 non-zero local cohomology if the multiplicity is 1. So we wonder if this is true in general. So a naive question is that, is it true in general? Of course, any expert would laugh to me. No. In general, such a thing is not true because, for example, let me give you a very simple example. So this is a ring with multiplicity 1 because everybody has x here. It has depth 0. Because it is x times the maximal ideal, and it has dimension 2. So it's multiplicity 1, dimension 2, depth 0. But this ideal is not almost complete intersection. It has codimension 1, but it has 3 generators. It is not almost complete intersection. It is 1 before almost complete intersection. So such an inequality does not hold for almost complete intersection, for ideals which are not almost complete intersection. But we wonder if it is true for almost complete intersection. So what we could prove is the following. So let R be any almost complete intersection. I mean mixed characteristic or equicharacteristic. If multiplicity of R is at most 1, or dimension of R is at most 2, then okay, so we generalize the Samuel result for any ring, especially for mixed characteristic thing. Samuel result holds for only polynomial rings. And I must be homogeneous, so it only works in projective space. But we prove this for affine space. So any affine variety with multiplicity at most 1 satisfies this equation, has only at most 2 non-zero cohomology. And so it is our characteristic-free part. And in the second part, we prove that if R is equicharacteristic and multiplicity of R is at most 2, or dimension of R is at most 3, then again, this is a very interesting result. So you can go one step more, and you can prove that if your ring has multiplicity at most 2, then again, you have this nice inequality between multiplicity and the Cohen-Macaulay defect. And here we need equicharacteristic because, okay, so here we prove direct summon conjecture. I mean, theorem, direct summon theorem, the last result in mixed characteristic. So we have a characteristic free proof theorem here. But here we could not use that because the method that we applied actually need field. Ring contain the field, but so we need the equicharacteristic assumption here.
Equal characteristic that can be
No, contains a field. Of course, if it is characteristic P, it contains a field. Yes. Yes, can be a positive characteristic, but it contains an equicharacteristic. Equicharacteristic is equivalent to say contains a field. So it contains a field, so I mean equicharacteristic, but positive or zero, doesn't matter. But anyway, if multiplicity is at most two, this works. Okay, so we tried a lot to go further to prove for multiplicity three or higher dimension, but we couldn't actually so far. But fortunately, we found a counterexample with multiplicity 600. So, and it was in a theorem by people that were working on the Stillman conjecture. So Berder plus five others. Berder. Yes, Berder. Okay. It is Berder, actually, McCullough, Celestiano, Nunes, Stone, five other. So a big paper. You know this kind of project. Let's prove Stillman conjecture. So there are so many people working on the same. And they publish so many papers. So, okay, so that kind of project. Okay, but what did they do was interesting. So they build a family of examples with very big projective dimension. So for any field, there is an ideal with three generators of degree R2 in the polynomial ring X1, Xn, such that projective dimension of, so let me call this ring S. Projective dimension of S mod I is bigger than R to the R minus 1. So degree of the generators is R square, but projective dimension is R to the R minus 1. So then if you apply the Honecker result here, because these ideas are almost complete intersection, you can see that the multiplicity of these rings is at most R to the 4 minus R square plus 1. So then if you use the Auslander-Buxmann formula, you can see that if you put R equal to 5, then you have elements of degree 25 with multiplicity at most 600. And this guy is smaller than dimension minus steps. So one may not hope to improve this theorem for any multiplicity, at least cannot get over 600. But actually, it is not still clear to us what is the best upper bound for the multiplicity so that this inequality may hold. So the question that I would like to ask here is the following. So question, what is the biggest epsilon such that for any almost complete intersection R with multiplicity at most epsilon, one has okay, so this is the question. Our result shows that epsilon is bigger than 2. And this example shows that it is less than 599. But I actually don't know what is epsilon. I don't have any counterexample for multiplicity 3. But any result would be very interesting.
But now we assume it's equal characteristic.
Yes, even assume equal characteristic. Yes, I don't want to emphasize on mixed characteristic. You assume you have a polynomial ring, you have everything, you have a homogeneous ideal, everything is nice. But still, though, I don't know if epsilon can be 3 or not. Okay, so as you will see, the application will show that this is an interesting question. Question so far? I'm going to explain the applications. Explain the applications. Tree generated idea, exactly.
This, the
this is homogeneous idea. The bronze is a trivial idea, but here, yeah, this is important. Tree generated idea is already a lot. Yeah. But here is homogeneous. And on top of that, everybody of same degree. Yeah. Yeah. This is important. Okay. Okay, applications. Okay, let me prove the. Okay, I have like 10 minutes now. Okay. Let me talk a little bit.
Take 11.
11, okay, thanks. Okay, so resolution of singularity is asking what? You have. Let us find variety. You look for a smooth variety, okay, which is birational and proper. Okay, it is solved in characteristic zero, but it is open in characteristic p, and almost everybody is disappointed to prove that, or maybe somebody very hopeful to prove that. But anyway, in 70s, Faltzing posed another question. He said that forget smoothness. Is there a maculification for any variety? So, given a ring R, does there exist a Cohen-Macaulay ring S such that this is birational and proper? We don't want a smooth, we don't want regular. We want a Cohen-Macaulay thing. R is anything, R is just Noetherian. So, this was the Faltzing question. And so he could prove this when the non-Cohen-Macaulay locus of this guy has co-dimension 0 or 1, so very particular thing. And in 1999, Kawasaki actually completed this proof. Kawasaki proved that these always exist. In any characteristic, anything independent of the characteristic, very, very tricky things. So he constructed, you know, concretely the maculification of the variety. But the point is that one may not hope to substitute the proper condition with the finite condition. And actually, Bahargava Bahat in 2013, he presented lots of a family of examples that do not accept any finite maculification. Okay, a corollary of our result is that if multiplicity of the ring is at most 2, then there exists a finite maculification. This is interesting. So not only we can resolve the non-Cohen-Macaulay locus, but also we have a finite extension here. And so the result actually follows from this is a corollary of a small Cohen-Macaulay conjecture. So actually we prove that if a ring has multiplicity at most 2, then a small Cohen-Macaulay conjecture holds. So we prove this, and this implies everything here. But in multiplicity at most 2. The only thing that is known about a small Cohen-Macaulay conjecture is for ring with dimension at most 3, excellent ring with dimension at most 3. Here we assume R is complete, but complete doesn't matter. But even though we could prove this has a small Cohen-Macaulay, it has a small Cohen-Macaulay module, this ring, and that module actually provides that the stoification of R is actually Cohen-Macaulay, and so the Cohen-Macaulay, finite Cohen-Macaulayfication exists. Okay, the other corollary is about the Stillman conjecture. So this is actually a result that has already been proved by Honecke and Eisenbach, but they never published the result because of works of Hackester. So Hackester did many cases. So Honecke and Eisenbach haven't proved the result, but I think the result is very interesting. But anyway, we give here an independent proof for the same result. So we prove here that for k any field, any characteristic, and also I don't assume algebraically closed, then any ideal given by three quadrics has projective dimension at most 4. This is wonderful. Always 4. If you have 100 millions of variables and you define 3 quadrics, your project dimension stops in the 4 system. Okay, so I think I finished by just explaining the proof of this last result. So if you have 3 quadrics, so your ideal is 3 generators, so it has codimension 3, 2, or 1. If it is 3, then it is compound intersection, so it has project dimension 3. If it is 1, then there is a common divisor there. You can take it out, then you have a linear ideal, and so it is trivial. So then it has at most project dimension 3. So the only non-trivial case is when codimension of I is 2. So you have an almost complete intersection. But then the result of Honecke says that multiplicity of this guy is 2 to the 2 minus 2 minus 1, 2 minus 1, at most 3. Okay, so if it attained the maximum value, then R mod I is Cohen-Macaulay. If it is Cohen-Macaulay, then project dimension is 2. This is also trivial. So the only non-trivial thing is that when multiplicity is at most 2. But then you can use this theorem here, and you can show that 2 is bigger than dimension of R minus depth of R. And then you can use the Oslander-Brooks-Pohm formula, and this shows that this is projective dimension of R minus codimension of R. Codimension of R is 2. So this proves that projective dimension of R is at most 4. R mod I, sorry. That's it. So we proved this special part of Stillman conjecture, but I would say this is nice because one cannot recover this 4 using Ananian and Hackester result. This upper bound is not there. Anyway. Okay, thank you for your attention.